God loves you. It's a plaque on a wall in your grandmother's house. It's another Instagram post with another sunset. It's a cheap band-aid on a fatal wound. But God does love you. It's the only reason anything will ever matter. It's the difference between eternal death and endless life. It's the hope that remains when despair is exhausted. It's your place at the table with the Father who's always wanted you. God loves you. That's why I bow on my knees to ask the Father to give you His power deep inside, to keep His Son rooted in your heart, so you'll finally be strong enough to understand what cannot be known. God loves you.
Again, welcome this morning. Some of the announcements we have is that recordings of the service can be found on the YouTube channel. So please look that up and you can subscribe and like. Trinity Choir practice will be 4 p.m. on the Thursday, 20th of October. Alinda Ruthven's at 7:30. October 28th, Alinda Ruthven is having a Halloween party, movie, and pizza night. Alinda Ruthven is also, the UCW is making meat pies, so if anyone's interested, they're making approximately 500 pies. They still have some left, so if you would like to get in on that, contact Linda Hamilton. Her number's in the bulletin. Alinda Ruthven also has their 22 gift card project on the go, and order sheets for that have to be back in by November 14. Trinity UCW has apple, rhubarb, cherry, peach, and blueberry pies, $10 each. See Marg or any Trinity UCW member. Kingsville Food Bank, we have a box, I believe, in the narthex. Tuna, instant oatmeal packets, toothpaste, pasta sauce, hand soap, and canned tomatoes are what's needed at this time. And if there's any birthdays or anniversaries or anybody that needs to be removed from the list, please get a hold of Brenda at the office and she'll see that names are removed. Any other announcements? Okay, we'll start with our call to worship. Come to worship God. Come to be inspired to live lives of faith and action. Come to be renewed personally, spiritually, and as a community. Gather as people of faith. We seek to live as servants of Christ. The Spirit moves among us, and we are open to being transformed. Winds of new opportunity blow among us. We are not alone, for God is with us. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Creator God, we come into your presence today with grateful hearts. The fall season continues to unfold and the harvests are gathered in. As the frenzy of activity slows with the shortening of daylight, we are aware of your very present nature. And as we pause now to worship you on this Sabbath day, remind us again that you are here, and that you are always where your people gather to sing, to pray, to rest in your name. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is Open My Eyes That I May See, Voices United 371. Thank you. going to ask you to join with me in prayer of confession. There are things that we do or neglect to do that can weigh heavily and keep us separated from God. Let us lighten our load in a prayer of confession. Let us pray. Holy Confessor, what is happiness to those who feel the weight of failure like an unwanted backpack upon their back? We often fall short of your will for us. We can be unbending and stubborn, a stubbornness that can leave us sleeping in sorrow. Silently stewing, our complaints can boil over in hurtful ways. Forgetting you, our strength leaches out. We reach out to you now, Holy One. Remind us of your love. We can acknowledge our failings and admit what weighs us down as we share in this moment of silence. Hear now these words of assurance. Our gracious One already knows all we hide and we are ashamed of. God embraces our vulnerability. God's grace proves stronger than our guilt. It is in seeking we are found, and our prayers is freedom. Even as the storm clouds gather and flood waters rise, God is our refuge. Love surrounds us, teaches us, shows us, guides us, and counsels us. Trust moors with us within, unfailing love. Our joy and happiness are anchored in our beloved, heart of our hearts and joy of our joys. Receive forgiveness with gratitude through Christ in the Spirit's power, trusting in God's grace. Amen. So now we're going to have our Young at Heart moment, the Pestering Widow with the puppets. And then we're going to have a song called Read Your Bible Every Day. And then the Trinity Choir will be singing Discipleship. And then we'll have Emily with our readings for this morning.
Please, Jesus, let me win the music award. Please, please, Jesus, I need to win that award. I'm trusting you, Jesus, to let me win that award. Oh, please let me win. Amen.
Susie, what are you doing?
I'm praying like the persistent widow in the Bible story we just heard. If I ask Jesus over and over and over and over, then He's going to give me what I ask for.
Susie, I don't think you were really listening to the story.
Well, I heard some of it, and then I started thinking about this music award I really want to win.
Susie, a parable has one main point, and if you miss the main point, then you will not understand what Jesus was teaching.
Well, what is the main point?
The main point is about God. The judge in the parable doesn't fear God. That means he doesn't understand God's power and holiness. The judge doesn't care about doing right. He doesn't care about the poor widow and the fact that someone has wronged her.
That's not right. A judge should want to see justice done.
The parable wants us to see that God is not like the judge. God does care about what is right. He does care for people who are poor and helpless. He does care when his children are wronged. Because he cares, we can pray and know God hears and he will answer.
I think I see what you're trying to tell me. We can pray to God for help because he cares about us.
Right! We are to keep on praying to God and not get discouraged when answers don't come right away because we know how much he loves us. But remember, Susie, we need to ask that God's will be done, not ours.
So I can keep on praying to win the music award?
Why don't you ask God to help you do your best in the music competition? And tell him that you will love him and trust him even if you don't win. but that you really want His will to be done.
But I really, really want to win.
Do you want God's will done or your will done?
God's will.
Then pray, but trust God's answer. Bye, kids.
Hallelujah. That's right, children. Let us grow in the Lord together. Let's sing this.
Read your Bible. Pray every day. Pray every day. Pray every day. Read your Bible. Pray every day. And you grow, grow, grow. Read your Bible. Pray every day. Pray every day. Pray every day. Read your Bible.
The first reading is taken from Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 27 to 34. Let us listen to the word of God. Be ready, the time's coming when I will plant people and animals in Israel and Judah, just as a farmer plants seeds. And in the same way that earlier I relentlessly pulled up and tore down, took apart and demolished, so now I am sticking with them as they start over, building and planting. When that time comes, you won't hear the old proverb anymore. Parents ate the green apples, their children got the stomach ache. No, each person will pay for his own sin. You eat green apples, you're the one who gets sick. That's right, the time is coming when I will make a brand new covenant with Israel and Judah. It won't be a repeat of the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took their land to lead them, their hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant even though I did my part as their master. This is the brand new covenant that I will make with Israel when the time comes. I will put my law within them, write it on their hearts, and be their God, and they will be my people. They will no longer go around setting up schools to teach each other about God. They'll know me firsthand, the dull and the bright, the smart and the slow. I'll wipe the slate clean for each of them. I'll forget they ever sinned. This is the word of the Lord. The responsive reading is taken from Psalm 119, verses 97 to 104, found on page 840 in Voices United. Margaret, could you please play the refrain? Oh, how I love your law. It is my study all day long.
Your commandment makes me wiser than my enemies, for it is always with me.
I have gained more insight than all my teachers, for your instruction is my study.
I have more understanding than the aged, for I keep your commandments.
I have held my feet back from every evil way in order to keep your word.
I have not served your judgments, for yourself.
How sweet is your word on my tongue, sweeter than honey in my mouth.
Your commandments I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way.
The second reading is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 to chapter 4, verse 5. Let us listen to the word of God. But don't let it faze you. Stick with what you learned and believed, sure of the integrity of your teachers, why you took in the sacred scriptures with your mother's milk. There's nothing like the written word of God for showing you the way to salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Every part of scripture is God-breathed and useful one way or another, showing us truth, exposing our rebellion, correcting our mistakes, training us to live God's way through the word we are put together and shaped up for the tasks God has for us. I can't impress this on you too strongly. God is looking over your shoulder. Christ himself is the judge with the final say on everyone living and dead. He is about to break into the open with his rule. So proclaim the message with intensity. Keep on your watch. Challenge, warn, and urge your people. Don't ever quit. Just keep it simple. You're going to find that there will be times when people will have no stomach for solid teaching, but will fill up on spiritual junk food, catchy opinions that tickle their fancy. They'll turn their backs on truth and chase mirages. But you, keep your eyes on what you're doing. Accept the hard times along with the good. Keep the message alive. Do a thorough job as God's servant. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Emily.
Let us pray. God of ages, through these passages from long ago, touch us and teach us in the here and now. You are our God, and you call us just as you called others long ago. Open our hearts to receive your call this day. Amen. Our gospel reading this morning is from Luke 18, verses 1 to 8. Then Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. In that city there was a widow who kept coming to him saying, grant me justice against my opponent. For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because of this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming. And the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says, and will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Okay, we're going to sing the opening, and then verses 1 and 2, and then the opening again. And I know it's going to come up, I think, a little different, Beth. So be prepared for that. Voices United, More Voices United, 79. Spirit, open my heart. I titled my sermon this morning, The Squeaky Wheel. Now, before the collapse of the Soviet Union years ago, the Russian author Alexander Solzhenitsyn spent many years in the prison camps of Siberia. And along with other prisoners, he worked in the fields day after day, in the rain and the sun during summer and winter. His life appeared to be nothing more than backbreaking labor and slow starvation. The intense suffering reduced him to a state of despair. And on this one particular day, the hopelessness of his situation became too much for him. He saw no reason to continue his struggle, no reason to keep on living. His life made no difference in the world, so he gave up. Laying his shovel on the ground, he slowly walked to a crude bench and sat down. He knew that any moment the guard would order him to stand up And when he failed to respond, the guard would beat him to death, probably with his own shovel. He had seen it happen to other prisoners. And as he waited head down, he felt a presence. And slowly he looked up and saw a skinny old prisoner squat down beside him. The man said nothing. Instead, he used a stick to trace in the dirt the sign of the cross. The man got back up and returned to his work. As Solzhenitsyn stared at the cross traced in the dirt, his entire perspective changed. He knew he was only one man against the all-powerful Soviet Empire, and yet he knew there was something greater than evil he saw in the prison camp, something greater than the Soviet Union, and he knew that the hope for all people was represented by that simple cross. Through the power of the cross, anything was possible. He slowly rose to his feet, picked up his shovel, and went back to work. Outwardly, nothing had changed. Instead, he had received hope. What that skinny old prisoner did for him, Jesus does for us today in the telling us about the insistent widow and the unscrupulous judge. As Solzhenitsyn desperately needed a renewal of hope, so we need encouragement from time to time if we are to continue in prayer and not lose heart. The skinny old prisoner made lines in the dirt, but Jesus does something different. He tells us this story. There is this judge, Jesus said, who has neither decency nor conscience, a corrupt public official interested only in his own advantage. A widow appears in his courtroom. She's poor and powerless, somebody not noticed by the movers and shakers in her town. She has no money to bribe the crooked judge, and she can't afford a lawyer to speak up for her. So you know what she does? She speaks for herself. "Defend me from my adversary," she shouts at the judge. And when this does not bring her immediate results, she remains undaunted, and she keeps returning to the courtroom and refuses to be silent. "Defend me from my adversary," she shouts. It is no surprise that the judge soon grows weary of this. In the original Greek of the New Testament, he compares his face attitude to getting a black eye. To spare himself further annoyance, he decides not simply to hear her case, but to grant the justice that she wants. This widow with a big mouth, somebody regarded by society as just another loser, manages to get her way in the courtroom of an unscrupulous judge. Will wonders never cease? Now, Jesus tells us this story to encourage us to continue in prayer and not lose heart. What's the point? Is the unscrupulous judge who does justice to spare himself annoyance, is this a portrait of God? I don't think that's what Jesus has in mind, though certainly this is how some people look at the practice of prayer. They paint a picture of God as an unscrupulous judge, or a petty bureaucrat, or an arbitrary boss, or an abusive parent. With such a picture before him, it's startling that they ever pray at all. God is not like that. Instead, the Lord is the author of all justice and compassion. It may be that we are intimate in our prayer, the persistence shown by the widow, but if so, it is not because God is hard-hearted and uncaring. Let us take another look at that judge. What do we know about him? We know that he is unscrupulous, without decency or conscience. He doesn't respect people. There is no fear of God in him. He's a closed universe. And this judge always has it figured out, and he leaves no room for the possibility that God may have a more creative answer to questions his life presses upon him. Now, do we know anyone that matches that description? We sure do. Each one of us can fit that description sometimes, and some of us may make a career of doing so. And there are those times all too often when each of us lives entirely unto ourselves, and we refuse to allow that God may have a creative solution to the problems that beset us, that God may offer us better things than we can ask for or imagine. Our decisions about life then leave no room for God and no room for other people whose needs and wishes differ from our own. The universe as we understand it becomes very small, and we are the sole inhabitant. If then the judge represents us, who does the loud-mouthed widow represent? Could it be that this poor and powerless woman who demonstrates unlimited chutzpah is there as a reminder of God? Certainly this fits. God is ever attempting to break into our closed universe, to draw us into a relationship, make us recognize what our relationship with God and our neighbor demands of us. God is not the unjust God, but the widow who wears him down. When there then is the unjust judge to be found, listen carefully. That judge is inside each of us, and the purpose of our prayer is to wear him down, to wear him out, and to force him to do justice. Prayer is the widow's voice, strident yet sane, insisting that things be different. Many people have trouble with prayer, or even give up the practice because they think that praying is an exercise of telling God what he already knows, or presenting to God do what he wouldn't do otherwise, or somehow challenging God in one way or another. Prayer, any prayer worth the name, is quite the opposite. The primary effect of prayer is not on God, but on us. God's love is already unconditional, his justice perfect, his compassion without limit, and he recognizes our needs even before we do. It is not God who needs to change. It is up to us to get in line with God's program, and prayer is a large part of how that comes about. Prayer is our declaration that we don't want to be a closed universe dependent only on ourselves and our own solutions. Prayer is our desire to be open to God. In our prayer, the Holy Spirit speaks in the voice of the poor widow who demands justice from the unscrupulous judge. The miracle of prayer is that the judge's resistance breaks down, and for once he does what is right, and may even do so again in the future. That loudmouthed widow would not have succeeded had she not been persistent, confident, and unconcerned with what others thought of her. She had what is known in Yiddish as zitzpah, and our prayer needs to have zitzpah, not because God is deaf, but because opening our hearts to God is not an easy matter. There are many things in each of us that can keep God out. Sin is not the only obstacle. Attitudes of mind may keep the door shut and bolted, and we may doubt that God hears us, and we may consider ourselves unworthy, and we may think that God has better things to do than intervene in our lives. These attitudes can be driven out by persistent prayer and the voice of the widow who refuses to take no for an answer. May each of us long to pray, learn to pray, and persist in our prayer, not so that we can change God, but so that God can change us and help us enjoy that fulfillment of life he intends for us. Amen. And we're going to sing More Voices United, Spirit Open My Heart, verses 2 and 3 again.
As you are in me.
And ask that you stand and join with me in the affirmation of faith. Stand as able. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Be seated. Our offering. Loving God, we receive and bless these gifts we offer in Jesus' name. By your blessing, may we and our gifts continue to be transformed for your mission of the world. In our giving, may we discover our purpose to love unconditionally, to dare courageously, and to reach out humbly. Amen. Compassion, O God, is symbolized by what we offer for your mission, the electronic transfers, the online donations, the envelopes, the pre-authorized remittance, the loose bills and the change or monetary contributions that enable us to reach into the community and the world. May you bless our gifts that we may become blessings for our neighbors. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Let us pray. I watched the wind scattering the leaves today, God. It wouldn't let them rest, spread smoothly all around. It couldn't let them stay in neatly raked piles, but like a restless child had to keep poking and picking at the edges until the neat heaps frayed and the leaves were once again scattered into the corners. We are perhaps a little scattered, God. The busyness of our lives pokes and picks at our attempts to manage and arrange everything into tidiness. Restless breezes tug at our hearts and minds when we try to concentrate. And like wind-blown leaves, our thoughts leap from one thing to another. Hush the winds for a moment so that we can catch our breath, the breath of your Spirit. We pray for all who live shattered lives and who find no chance to breathe, for families faced with challenges of caring for the elderly and raising children, for those who face violence and fear every day, for those who are ill. The gusts that stir our lives and unsettle them may be your holy breath, O unseen God. Keep us aware of the breezes that challenge us and bless us with your Holy Spirit wind. Let us be like the leaves who are stirred from stillness into dancing. Breathe on us, breath of God. Fill us with life anew, that we may love all that all that you love, and do what you would do. And all of these things we ask in Jesus' name, who calms the winds, and in the spirit which blows in unimagined ways. And in the prayer Jesus taught us, we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is I, the Lord of Sea and Sky, Voices 509. I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Thank you.
worship is drawing to a close and faith-filled living continues. We have heard the good news and we are encouraged to follow Christ's path. We have sung God's praises and we give thanks that we are not alone. May the love of God, holy mystery, always sustain you. May the grace of Jesus the Christ ever enfold you. May the wonder of the Holy Spirit grant you delight this day and forevermore. Amen.